Welcome back to Curious Archive. This video is the finale of my two-part series on the biology of the video game Subnautica. In these alien seas, breathtaking landscapes, enormous predators, and unexpected mysteries are still waiting to be discovered. And just like how life in Earth's oceans gets stranger the deeper you dive, the depths of planet 4546b are far more extreme than what's on the surface. They're also highly dangerous, and I can confidently say that this ranks among the scariest experiences I've had while doing fieldwork for the archive. But I'm determined to uncover the secrets of this ocean. So ride with me in my deep sea submersible as we conclude this expedition into the unknown. To the north, beyond the edge of the grassy plateaus, huge mushroom trees grow in abundance. Despite their name and appearance, mushroom trees are actually a particularly long-lived species of coral. In the shade of these ancient giants, a new classification of life is swimming. These are Jellyrays, an ethereal ray species with highly translucent bodies. In Earth's oceans, translucent lifeforms are quite common in the lower light depths. The Jellyrays are therefore a sign we're getting closer to the deeper, and more fantastical, regions of 4546b. Beyond the safety of the mushroom forest, the twilight of the bulb zone awaits. Here, luminescent bulb bushes dominate the landscape, and have evolved to grow in this rocky, sandy environment thanks to a highly advanced system of roots. And along the seafloor, raging volcanic geysers launch boiling liquid and chunks of molten rock into the surrounding water. The extreme heat from these geysers charboils any fish that swims too close. An ominous light flickers in the murk. The source is an Ampeel, a huge serpentine predator covered with glowing prongs that produce zaps of electricity. These aggressive creatures use electric discharges to intimidate other life forms and kill their prey with a single deadly shock. Such living batteries might seem biologically inexplicable, but the curious electric eel on Earth might help demonstrate how an organic creature could produce an electric field. Electric eels use disc-shaped cells packed into specialized organs to generate their electric currents, as incredible as that might sound. So it's possible that the Ampeel's prongs contain similar cells, although the bioelectricity of an Ampeel is far more extreme. A series of screeches announces the approach of a legion of bone sharks. Highly aggressive and territorial carnivores, it's unlucky to encounter so many at once. Their thickly armored exoskeletons, which give them their names, are adapted not just to deter larger predators, but also other bone sharks. The distinctive segmentation of these exoskeletons suggests bone sharks might share a common ancestor with the sand sharks we glimpsed on our last outing. If so, it's a fearsome family tree. While returning to the shallows to prepare for the next leg of my journey, I spot a new type of colorful fish. Something about the way it looks is truly hypnotic, and I want to swim closer, and then it bites my nose. That is a Mesmer, a sneaky little creature that looks harmless while its four fins are folded up, but unfurled can create hypnotic patterns that have evolved to distract prey while it goes in for the kill. Thankfully, it seems I'm a bit too big to be swallowed up, but this is one fish to avoid. With supplies replenished, it's time to venture further into the unknown. Under the seafloor, networks of caves lead deeper into the uncharted interior of planet 4546b. Some of these caves are massive and contain entire ecosystems of their own. And the Jellyshroom Cave is one of the most miraculous. Here, among the stalagmites, grow jellyshrooms, massive, highly luminescent flora which might be distantly related to the tiny acid mushrooms of the shallows. In the purple light of the jellyshrooms shine the biters, small carnivores that stalk these caves for small prey. The antenna on their forehead seems to resemble the deep-sea anglerfish's lure at first glance, but the biter's antenna actually serves an entirely different purpose. It contains olfactory organs that help it detect bodily fluids in the water. In other words, the biter can smell its prey anywhere in the cavern. Unless, of course, the biter becomes prey itself. Winding through the cave is an unsettlingly lengthy crab snake, the apex predator of this environment. What makes this predator so deadly is not just its size, but its ability to hide in plain sight. The crab snake has a symbiotic relationship with the local jellyshrooms, using their hollow interior as the perfect lair from which to ambush prey. In behavior and appearance, the crab snake somewhat resembles Earth's bobbit worm, an unattractive predator that also ambushes its prey. In the Jellyshroom Caves, one needs to keep an eye out. Elsewhere on the seafloor, another shadowy cavern beckons. After many hours navigating the cave system, I surface in a cave that strangely seems lit by daylight. I realize I've stumbled upon something extremely rare for planet 4546b, dry land. This tiny island is the peak of an undersea mountain connected to an aquatic cave system, and it's one of the few places on the planet you can encounter terrestrial life. Scuttling along the beach are cave crawlers. As their name implies, these crab-like creatures have evolved to crawl along the sides of cave walls, which is likely why they were able to adapt to this fleeting landmass relatively quickly. Analysis of their biology suggests they possess a gas exchange membrane to breathe air, instead of fully functional terrestrial lungs. Soaring overhead is a life form that has spent much more time adapting to life above the waves. This is a Skyray, an avian creature that has, remarkably, evolved powered flight. Although its wings give it some resemblance to aquatic ray species, analysis shows no particular genetic link. Instead, the Skyray appears to have split off from the common evolutionary tree much earlier than most other species on the planet, perhaps at a time when dry land was more prevalent. In any case, it seems we've now seen all this island has to offer. Or maybe not. On one end of the island is a tremendous artificial spire. This mysterious monolith appears to be the work of advanced extraterrestrials, who, much like myself, came to this planet from afar. But did they come to study the life here like I did, or were their intentions more sinister? In any case, it seems this planet's greatest secret is still waiting to be uncovered. To the south, the seafloor plunges lower than ever before. We have come upon the Grand Reef. Here, orb-like blue plants called anchor pods risk floating off due to their gas-filled membrane, only staying in place due to their net-like root system. And nearby stomp a herd of sea treader leviathans. These vast herbivores roam the depths in search of plants on which to graze. The thunderous nature of their rhythmic steps is truly something to experience. Perhaps the most curious thing about these creatures is the fact they have three legs, something almost never glimpsed in nature. Analysis suggests their front leg is actually an elongated snout, used to siphon plant material from the seafloor and to maintain balance. As alien as this might seem, there are some species of Earth tripod fish with elongated fins they used to similarly stand on the seafloor. Right now, it appears the sea treader leviathans are migrating, so it's best not to disturb them. Beneath the Grand Reef, caverns take us further into the abyss. Here, the intimidating crab squid waits to butcher prey with its 10 limbs. Swim close to one, and they'll unleash a mysterious bioelectric discharge, which has the properties of an electromagnetic pulse. While they appear to have massive brains, analysis suggests the large organ within their translucent sac is actually their stomach, which the crab squid fill with their bioluminescent prey. As a result, they seem attracted to light sources, convincing me to make a hasty exit from my submarine. This turns out to be a good call, as it drags my sub into the depths. If there are other creatures like the crab squid on the prowl down here, I'm going to need something a little larger. For the next perilous leg of the journey, I'll be piloting a Cyclops submarine. a vehicle that should be able to withstand the crushing depths of the abyss. Below the deep Grand Reef awaits a surreal environment of eerie green fog. This is the Lost River, a region covered in alkaline brine pools, which give the illusion of an underwater stream. Brine pools also exist in Earth's oceans and are extremely toxic due to their high salinity. Best not to get too close. Above these pools drift the haunting ghost rays. Relatives of the jelly rays from the mushroom forest, in these extreme depths, the ghost rays have become almost completely transparent, to the point where you can see the red of their internal organs. Elsewhere in the Lost River, blood crawlers, the spindly relatives of the cave crawlers, stride above the brine on stilt-like legs, rather unsettling forms of life. In the central chamber, something truly horrifying is waiting. This ancient fossil belongs to a colossus far larger than any that currently swims through the seas. Indeed, it's so massive that its ribcage has become part of the Lost River's landscape. We should count ourselves lucky, this unknown genus seems to have gone extinct long ago. Yet still alive are the river prowlers. These aggressive, transparent predators haunt the gravesite of the Leviathan like vengeful ghosts. Even more frightening, their four-head tendrils can lash out when attacking, allowing them to pull in prey. Not the sort of creature you'd like to encounter in the dark. But there is a strange beauty to certain regions of the Lost River. In a cove under the central chamber, the brine becomes a harmless blue, and ghost rays flock around a massive central tree. This tree appears to be an ancient nesting ground, as it is grown around a giant bioluminescent egg. While the egg itself is beautiful, whatever hatches out of an egg that size might not be. To find the adult form of the huge creature that hatches from this egg, we must venture into the nightmarish darkness of the Dead Zone. Here, at the edge of the habitable region for most fauna, we've found our giants, or they've found us. These aggressive monsters are ghost leviathans, and they're a major threat to this expedition. Analysis of their jaws suggests they feed on microscopic lifeforms that help them reach their massive sizes, although they seem fully capable of feeding on something larger. Time to head back the way we came. The mystery of the giant egg has been solved, but that's not the only strange thing in the Lost River. These ruins of a massive alien structure resemble the one on the island. The structure is guarded by these lifeforms, the warpers, who possess a mind-bending ability. At will, they can somehow fold space-time and vanish into portals. This is not the ability of a natural lifeform. It seems we are dealing with an artificial creation. Searching for answers, I enter the ruined building. Here we can see the unfinished, artificial body of a warper. They did not evolve, and are a creation of the extraterrestrials. But for what purpose? Translating a digital message, it seems these alien architects came to 4546B many years ago, searching for a cure for a disease. And the warpers are their artificial quarantine enforcers. Given the lack of any living architects on 4546B, it appears that they were unsuccessful. On a table in a nearby lab, they've left behind an egg of a curious creature. After returning to the surface to recharge my submarine, I hatch the egg and this delightful lifeform emerges. This is a cuddlefish, a friendly, rotund little creature that displays high levels of intelligence and curiosity. I've also found it's quite a fan of treats. Analysis suggests it's possible this creature has been imported from another world, or even genetically altered to be extra friendly. It's possible the architect aliens kept them as pets, just like we do with dogs. It's tempting to stay longer with the cuttlefish in the shallows, yet I can't help but feel that in the abyss there are more mysteries I've yet to solve. Beneath the Lost River, the landscape blazes with the fiery glow of molten rock. We've reached the lava zone, the deepest environment of them all. Here, incredible heat-resistant forms of life have evolved, like the crimson ray, a ray species that have developed a molten coloring to help it blend in with the lava, and the magmarang, a relative of the boomerang with a beautiful glowing tail fin. Another remarkable form of life is the lava larva, a grub-like creature that feeds off geothermal and electrical energy. I first learned this fact when I found one stuck to the windshield of my Cyclops, draining its energy. While this behavior is somewhat annoying, the energy conversion capabilities of this creature are truly remarkable. On the molten floor is something highly alarming. These skeletons belong to Reaper Leviathans, like the one we encountered in our last voyage. It seems that somewhere in the lava zone is a predator so large it can drag Reaper Leviathans into the depths. This doesn't bode well. Basking in the red glow of the molten rock are lava lizards. These predators are too small to be our culprits, but they're nonetheless quite deadly. For defense, they are able to cover their bodies with hardened, lava-like natural armor. While such a behavior is far more extreme than anything on Earth, scalyfoot snails, which I've discussed on this channel before, can survive in volcanic vents by incorporating iron scales into their body like medieval armor. However, lava lizard biology takes this to a new level. At the end of the lava zone lurks a massive chamber. The loudest roar we've encountered on our voyage shakes the cavern. We found our Reaper Leviathan Slayer. This is a sea dragon leviathan, the largest predator in Subnautica. Possessing both arms and tentacles, these creatures exceed 350 feet, or 112 meters in length. Sea dragons get their name from their ability to consume molten materials and expel them at their adversaries like they're breathing fire. I can only hope this absurdly deadly lifeform doesn't notice me. No such luck. A huge blow from the Leviathan rocks the Cyclops submarine. As a result, there appears to be a minor leak. Out of options, I have to abandon ship. Luckily, I have one last hope in the prawn suit, a deep-sea mechanical walker that should make an ideal escape pod. Ejecting from the Cyclops, it's a bit of a drop to the bottom. But it appears my plan has worked, as the sea dragon Leviathan thinks its foe has been vanquished. Here, at the end of our journey, lies a final, mysterious building. With some difficulty, I pilot the prawn suit over to it. Inside, locked in a containment facility, the largest creature of Subnautica is waiting. This is a sea emperor leviathan, and although it appears to be a relative of the sea dragon, it is in no way hostile. Like real-world baleen whales, the largest creatures on Earth, its diet consists solely of microorganisms. While the sea emperor leviathan is so large I am unable to get a proper scan of it, it seems that it can somehow manipulate neurons to communicate telepathically, as it told me of its plight. The sea emperor was entombed here by the alien architects in the hope it could provide a cure for their disease, which I believe is in strict violation of the intergalactic code of biological ethics. At the request of this intelligent creature, I agree to take its hatchlings back to the surface with me. Watching the first moments of baby sea emperors' lives is a truly wondrous experience, even after all the biological marvels I've glimpsed thus far. Sadly, the sea emperor is at the end of its lifespan, and informs me that it won't be coming with us. At the very least, I'm happy I can help their babies live on in freedom. It is a bittersweet conclusion to a long and winding journey. With the sea emperor babies returning to their natural habitat, our study of this region of Subnautica is at its end. There are other worlds waiting for us, and the time has now come to return to the stars. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support, and like, subscribe, and hit the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.